praise the name of the Lord. It's a privilege for us and you know, a joy to be able to share the word of God with you today. We want to talk about a very important subject, something that is more than necessary for every believer to understand in this timing and season where walking with God is essential. I'm not just talking about knowing God. I'm not just talking about going to church. I'm not just talking about having, you know, or belonging to a religion. I'm talking about journeying with the Lord. I'm talking about walking with God. And unless we have the understanding of how possible it is to walk and to journey with the Lord, we cannot make it. My Bible says that the end of a thing is better than its beginning. And that is what we want to talk about. We want to talk about the power of focus to finish well. Let us bow down our heads in prayer. Father, we give you praise and we give you honor. We thank you for your word. Father, your word is spirit and life. Your word is yea and amen. The entrance of your word gives light to the simple. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. And everything that was made by the word. And nothing that was made without the word. The word of God is the light unto men. The word of God is Alpha and Omega, is beginning and end. The word of God is the power that sustains everything that exists. By the power of the word, Father God in heaven, you created everything that exists. I want to give you praise because you didn't leave us empty. You gave us an inheritance through the word. You have exalted your word even above your name. And today we want to pray, Father God, that the hearing of your word will empower us, O Lord, to run with purpose, to journey, Father God, with vision, and to be able to leave a legacy to our generation and to fulfill our divine assignment. We give you praise, O Lord. Father, I commit everyone listening to me at this moment into your mighty hand. I pray, Father God, that this will not just be another hearing. This will not just be, my God and my King, another sermon or another exhortation. But I pray that this will challenge somebody, Father God, or empower someone, Father God, to moving forward in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I pray that the Holy Spirit Divine will walk through this video and bless somebody and touch somebody and empower somebody and edify somebody to the praise and the glory of your holy name. I humble myself into your mighty hand. Lord, speak through me. Glorify your name and bless the life. Edify your people, put the devil to shame, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. As I was saying a moment ago, friends, I believe that journeying with God is not an easy thing. I said it in the beginning of my talking. I said that the end of a thing is better than its beginning. And that is not my word. That is God speaking to His people. That is the wisdom through the word of God, through the Bible. What is important to the Lord is not how you start. What is important to the Lord is not how far you've gone today. What is important to the Lord is how well you finish, how ready you are to run till the end. Our greatest example is our Master, the Lord Jesus. I believe that every Christian that has the intention to leave a legacy to his generation, every Christian that has the intention, you know, to journey successfully with the Lord, every Christian that has the intention to mark his own impression on this world before leaving this world, any person that believes that God did not just bring him into this world as an accident, but as a message, as a solution, I believe that we need to have the right information to walk and successfully walk. Jesus is our example. Jesus is the author and the consumer of our faith. Jesus is the beginning and the end. Jesus is our model. by excellency. Jesus is the utmost model we have, and he showed us the right way to walk. Jesus always referred to the Father in his journey and his commission on earth. He always referred to the Father. I believe that he referred to the Father as his mentor. He referred to the Father as his source of information. He referred to the Father as his guide. And he didn't leave us orphans. When he was about to leave this world, he said that he told to the disciples, he turned to the disciples and he told them, I'm not leaving you orphans. I'm leaving you with the Spirit of the living God, the Holy Spirit divine. And his assignment in your life will be to lead you in all the truth. And the Word and the Spirit are one. Jesus is the Word. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And everything that was made by the Word. And nothing that was made out of the Word. And the Bible says that the Word of God, which is the light, came unto his own. He came into darkness, and darkness could not comprehend him. The people that want to make it with the Lord today should be people that are ready to be an enigma. Should be people that are ready, you know, to stand alone. Should be people that are ready to focus. I want to talk about the power of focus to leave a good legacy for this generation. I want to talk about the power of focus to successfully journey with the Lord. And in talking about that important subject, I'm going to refer to two stories in the Bible. The first one is about somebody very important in the scriptures. I think is one of the most important people as long as the mission of our Lord Jesus Christ on earth is concerned. The Bible talks about John the Baptist. I want to go back to the story of his family. In the book of Luke, let us go into our Bibles. In the book of Luke, chapter 1, from verse 5. My Bible talks about the parents of John the Baptist. And from verse 5, the Bible says, there was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zechariah. I want to stop there and say that the Bible talks about a certain priest. You know, when the Bible talks about a certain, whenever a word like a certain is used, it means to me that it could have been any other person. It could have been any other priest. You know, there was nothing special about him that made him to be the choice of God for that visitation. I just believe that this man positioned himself. I just believe that this man was the type of people God is seeking for today. The type of people that are ready to stand right with God. The type of people that are ready to be radical with the God of their salvation. The type of people that have made up their mind and that are fixed, you know, about their decision to following God. The type of people, as the Bible recommends, that put their hands upon the plow and will never look behind. The type of people that have made up their mind to leave a legacy to their generation. I want to insist on that. Christianity is not just about parading and about, you know, speaking a lot of words, a lot of empty words. It's about giving something to this generation. And let me tell you, it is not an easy thing, because we face a lot. We face discouragement. We face challenges. We face people's opinions. We face one thing or the other that is ready to distract us. And we face our utmost enemy, the devil, and his horde. And his army, ready, you know, to see us failing, ready to see us giving up on our assignment. My Bible said that Zechariah was a certain priest, and he was of the cause of Abia, and his wife of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. These two people, the priest Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth, they were covenant people. We can liken them today in our generation to you and me who are born again. And besides being born again, we have decided to go an extra mile and serving the Lord. We have decided to go an extra mile and representing the kingdom of God. They were of that generation of people, of that class of people that were the chosen, the covenant people of God. And my Bible says that they belong to that lineage of people that serve the Lord. They were of the class of the priesthood. They were of the class of the Levite. They were of the family of Aaron. And my Bible says that, and they were both righteous. I want to insist upon that. They were both righteous. They were both holy. They were both consecrated unto the God of their salvation. They had both taken the decision to glorify the Lord their God with their life. They have both decided that everything about them will be about the God of their calling. And the Bible says they were both righteous before God and walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord. And this is what the Bible says, blameless. This is an excellent report about children of God. You know, I don't believe that the Bible is just giving this account of these two people just to please us or just by accident. No, I believe that every word that is mentioned here is important and it's meaningful. My Bible says that both of them were righteous. My Bible says that both of them were faithful. They were walking in all the commandments of God and all the ordinances and blameless. But there was a comma in their life. There was a stigma attached to their life. There was a label, a negative label that life had put upon them. My Bible says that they had no child. Walking with God is a journey. And this is a mistake that many people do about their walk with God. They compare their walk with God, with what they feel. You know, their walk with God, their journey with God, their zeal with God depend on what they feel, depend on the circumstances around their life, depend on the feeling of people about them, depend on so many factors. But this is a people that had that stigma upon their life. They had that comma upon their life, but still that never stopped them from having that constant and for having that steadfast walk with the Lord. Their walk with God was not about ups and downs. The Bible said that they were righteous. The Bible said that they were walking according to the ordinances and according to the commandments of God blamelessly. Blamelessly. That is very important to me. And that is something that we are lacking today in the process of our walk with God. How many of us have looked behind because we are facing some challenges? How many of us have decided to slow down our zeal, to slow down on our prayer life, to slow down on our reading of the Bible, to slow down on our commitment, to slow down on our assignment, to slow down on the respect we have for the things of God, the sacred things of God, on the respect we have for the vessels of God, on our commitment to slow down on our journey with the Lord just because of what we are facing. My Bible says that Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth were both faithful, were both righteous, were both committed, were both blameless in all the ordinances of the Lord. You know, when the Bible is talking right here, I don't believe that the Bible is just talking about their attitude before their visitation. I believe that I mean, after their visitation, I believe that their steadfastness, their commitment, their faithfulness, and their obedience to the word of God was something that had become a part of them, a habit, a discipline. They were focused about it. They had decided that nothing will change them. And that is what God is seeking about us today. We are living in such a perverse generation. We are living in such a compromised generation. We are living in such an unbelieving generation that it is easy for children of God to maybe not just give up or abandon their faith, but compromise a little lie, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little wrong relationship here and there. You know, God wants us to set a standard about His kingdom in spite of what we are going through, in spite of what we are facing, in spite of the different issues of life we are going through, in spite of the ups and downs, in spite of who is with us or who is against us. Joshua had to step apart. Joshua had to stand out in his generation and make a declaration. And that is the declaration I believe every priesthood, every house, every believer must have today. He declared that me and my household, we choose to serve the Lord. We choose to serve the Lord. The journey of Christianity is about making the right choice. What is the choice you are making today that will help you to focus and to run with purpose and to leave a legacy to your generation? What is the decision that you have decided to take in spite of who believes in you and who doesn't believe in you? There is a lot of distraction today in Christianity. How many of us are surrounded with those people, even in our household, who don't believe in the God of our salvation? And because of that, we reduce our standard, the standard of our faith. How many of us, because of who refuse to associate with us, we decide to reduce our standard in our faith and our walk with the Lord? How many of us are just waiting to define our life on the basis of the definition we receive from people? We have to get to that place where our definition of who we are doesn't come from our circumstances, doesn't come from who believes in us or not, doesn't come from what we have or what we don't have, doesn't come from our achievement or our non-achievement, but of who our God is and the reason and the understanding of His calling upon our life and focusing upon it. I so much commend the life of this great man and this great woman of God. In spite of this coma, in spite of this label upon their life, I believe that in their generation, it wasn't easy. Let me tell you, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy to be a priest, to be of the family of the Levite, and to be at that place where you had an obvious lack in your life. You had an obvious question upon your life and still be faithful in your assignment. I believe that many people sometimes came to Zechariah and to his wife Elizabeth, and they had some issues with giving birth to kids, and Zechariah and the wife would be like, can I pray for them? No, I believe that they had to overcome those questions. I believe that they had to overcome shame. I believe that they had to overcome mockery. I believe that they had to overcome despise. I believe that they had to overcome the reflection of themselves, you know, from the eyes of the people. I believe that sometimes Elizabeth was looking at people's eyes, and even though they were not speaking, she was able to read and hear through their eyes their question. Hey, if you are really serving God, why is it that you don't have a child? If your husband is a priest, why is it that there is that coma in your life? You know, for them, it was about children. But it can be something else. It can be money for us. It can be achievement for us. It can be an association. It can be people's opinion. It can be one thing or the other. My Bible says they were righteous. They were faithful. They obeyed the ordinances and the commandments of the Lord their God. To go back to the scriptures, the Bible says they had no child because Elizabeth was barren. But to cut the story short, my Bible declares that in the course of executing his work, executing the priestly office before God in the order of his course, my Bible says it came to pass. Let me tell somebody today, one thing with the word of God is that no matter how long it tarries, the word of God will surely fulfill the reason for which it is sent. Just a promise of God is enough. That is all you need to have. And for you to be steadfast, for you to be focused, you need to get to that place where you receive that word from God. That word that will comfort you. That word that will give you the assurance that, hey, it might not yet have come to pass, but it will certainly come to pass because he that has spoken is faithful. My Bible says one thing about the word of God. It never gets back to the Lord without fulfilling the purpose for which it was sent. Even as the dew comes down from heaven and doesn't go back up without touching the ground, such is the word of God. The Bible declared that it doesn't go back to the Lord without fulfilling the purpose for which it was released. And I want to pray for somebody today to hold on there, to hang on there upon the word of God. No matter who believes in you or who doesn't believe in you, no matter the pressure of time and circumstances, there is a time for everything under the heaven. Every season has a beginning and an end. Let me tell you, no matter how strong the winter is, there is a beginning for the season of winter and there is an end for the season of winter. No matter how hot, you know, the summer decides to be, there is a beginning for the summer and there is an end for the summer. I'm talking today about the power of focus, the power of staying steadfast, committed, you know, to your calling, to the reason of your calling, in spite of who believes in you, who doesn't believe in you. What defines you is not people's opinion. What defines you is the assignment and the mandate that heaven has put upon you. One of the things that our Lord Jesus did when he came upon the earth, one of the things that he decided to do was to empower himself with the understanding of his purpose, with the understanding of his mission. My Bible says that Jesus went into the temple. You know, he went into his city. I believe that the Bible says it purposely. You know, he was a citizen or somebody that lived in Nazareth. And my Bible says that he went into the temple in Nazareth. And my Bible says that he took the book and he opened that page that talked about his mission and his assignment. And he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and he has anointed me for a reason and for a purpose. You know, to heal the sick, to deliver the oppressed, to announce the acceptable year of the Lord unto his generation. You know, to bless his generation. Jesus knew the reason why he came. He had the right understanding. Luke chapter 4 verse 18 tells us that Jesus did not just open the Bible or the scroll in confusion. He opened it with the understanding. He had gone through the scroll and he saw the portion of the word that was relating to his commission, and he stick onto it. One of the reasons of, you know, many people making a shipwreck of their walk with the Lord and of their faith today is that they fail to seek for the reason of their commission. That is why when it is blowing in the east, they are there. When it is blowing on the west, they are there. When it is blowing in the north, they are there. When it is blowing in the south, they are there. They run with no purpose and with no vision. They are carried away, you know, by any wind that blows. That is not the will of God about us. God wants us to understand the reason of our calling. If you are called to be a preacher, be the best in it.
If you are called to be a mother, be the best in it. If you are called to be a businessman, understand your purpose and run with vision. You know, the grace that is released upon your life is released according to the mission and the vision or the commission heaven has for you. It is not given. God doesn't just spoil his grace. God doesn't just, you know, make a waste of his grace. For every assignment, for every commission, there is a divine grace release. If you want to function in an assignment that is not yours, you are going to make a shipwreck because there is no grace to function in that assignment. And therefore, to come back to my story, Zechariah and the wife understood it and they remained constant. They remained focused. They remained faithful. They ran with vision. They waited for the time of their visitation. They were watching upon the seasons and the timing. They were committed. You know, they didn't. God is going to meet you at the place of your faithfulness. He's not going to meet you at the place of your complaint. He's not going to meet you at the place of your giving up. He will meet you at the place of your focus, at the place of your faithfulness, at the place of your steadfastness, at the place of your commitment. That is where the Lord is going to meet you and reward you. To continue in my exhortation, my Bible says that these two people remain faithful, and God needed a vessel to use to announce the coming of the deliverer, the coming of our master. And God prepared, you know, or found for himself a vessel through Elizabeth and Zechariah. And the great man of God that we all celebrate today, John the Baptist, was born through them. And my Bible says that he was the voice of him who was crying in the desert, announcing that the kingdom of God is near and exhorting or commanding everybody to repent. And he did it, you know, with great zeal. And he did it with passion. And my Bible says that the Lord Jesus, you know, I'm just paraphrasing, the Lord Jesus came to meet him that day of divine appointment to be baptized and just to fulfill all righteousness. Even though the Lord Jesus was his master, he decided, you know, to remain focused. There is nothing you lose in being humble. There is nothing you lose in abasing yourself at any given moment in your life. There is nothing you lose in humbling yourself, you know, for the reason of increase, for the reason of allowing the will of God to come to pass. My Bible says that God resists the proud, but my Bible says that he honors the humble. And therefore, Jesus, that had the understanding of his purpose and the reason of his calling, and who was, you know, decided, who knew why he came, and who was not ready to let anything distract him, decided to go and humble himself and be baptized by John the Baptist, who was his servant. And my Bible says that that day the heavens opened upon our king, and the heaven presented him. This is my only begotten son in whom I am well pleased, said the father. And everybody heard it. I believe that John the Baptist heard it, you know. And from that moment on, Jesus went about his ministry first by being led into the desert by the Spirit to be tempted by the devil. And he remained focused, you know, for every temptation. He didn't give up because of food. He didn't give up because of riches. He didn't give up because of honor or who to adore. You know, he didn't sell his birthright. He remained focused. I want to encourage us, please, my brother, please, my sister, remain focused. Don't sell your birthright because of the difficulties you are going through. Don't sell your birthright because of hunger. Don't sell your birthright because of the definition people are having on you. Heaven counts on you, and I count on you, and the body of Christ counts on you. Be focused, be faithful. This generation needs us. This generation needs you. And my Bible says that John the Baptist, some few chapters later, John the Baptist saw Jesus passing, and he pointed unto him, and he told his disciples, "This is the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world." What a great statement with understanding. His eyes were spiritually open. He rejoiced upon the God of his salvation. He rejoiced upon his master. He rejoiced upon the ministry of Jesus. And the Bible says from that moment on, his disciples started following Jesus. And that is very important to me. His disciples started following Jesus. But reading my Bible, I don't have that account that tells me of what John the Baptist personally did from the moment that he knew that Jesus was the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. Did he also start following Jesus? What happened to him? What happened to him? My Bible says that his disciples started following Jesus. Wherever Jesus was going, healing the sick, some of the disciples of John the Baptist were there, and they witnessed it. They witnessed the healing of the sick. They witnessed the deliverance of the oppressed. They witnessed everything that Jesus was doing. And they went back to John the Baptist to give him the report of what Jesus was doing. And I started asking myself, but what was wrong with John the Baptist? Why is it that when his disciples were going and following Jesus, why is it that he didn't go also? Why is it that he didn't also follow the disciples in witnessing? So, to come back to what I was saying, please let us be very, very careful about our walk with God. What is important is not how well we start. What is important is how well we finish. How well we remain committed to what the Lord has put into our hands. How well we can finish and present, you know, the crown and be proud before him and say, "Oh Lord, I ran till the end. This is the multiplication of the talent you put into my hand." To paraphrase the story, you know, my Bible said that it came a time where John the Baptist, that we all know, it came a time in his life and his ministry that he faced problems. And what was the problem? He had an issue with people's marital problems, and he involved himself, you know, into judging marital issues. And another said because of that, he got imprisoned. And he sent his disciples to Jesus, and he asked a question that made me to really be, you know, a little bit confused. My Bible says that he sent two of his disciples to Jesus with a funny question: "Are you the one that is to come, or do we need to wait for another one? Are you the one that we are expecting, or do we need another one to come?" That is the question that John the Baptist, you know, sent his disciples to ask Jesus. What is wrong with the vision of John the Baptist? What is wrong with the understanding he had of who Jesus was? What happened to him meantime? How can you be the one that point at somebody and says, "This is the Lamb of God that taken away the sins of the world," and a few days later you are so confused about him? The reason is that John the Baptist was expecting Jesus to get distracted enough and focus on delivering him from the trouble he had put himself into. Let me tell you, in your walk with God, many people are going to try to distract you. Many people are going to try to make you fall apart on your walk with God. I want to pray that God will give you discernment on what to associate with, who to stop for, and what to involve yourself in.
And Jesus turned to them, you know, in that portion of the scripture, my Bible says that the disciples of John the Baptist had gone to witness what Jesus was doing. And they came back to John the Baptist and they told him, hey, John the Baptist, this man is doing wonders. He is healing the sick. He is delivering the oppressed. He's raising the dead. Great signs and wonders are following his ministry. But like few hours or few days later, John the Baptist still sent them and say, go and ask him, is he the one to come, or do we wait for another one? And you know, to close my exhortation tonight, this is where I want to land. My Bible says that Jesus turned to those disciples and he told them, go and tell John the Baptist that the lame are walking, that the deaf are hearing, that the dumb are speaking, that the dead are coming back to life, that the oppressed are delivered, and people are receiving the gospel of the good news. The acceptable year of the Lord is being declared. Go and tell him that I am still focused on my commission. I'm still focused on my assignment. I know why I came to this earth, and nothing is going to distract me. I know why I am called. I know why I am a pastor. I know why I am a singer. I know why I am born again, and nothing is going to distract me. I am speaking about you today. Don't let anybody's disappointment, you know, slow you down. Don't let anybody anybody's dying in his faith, you know, affect you anyhow. Don't let anybody's unbelief affect you. Don't let the persecution of this generation affect your faith. Believe in the God of your salvation. Key, you know, remain focused to the reason of your calling. The vision is for an appointed time, and it will certainly speak. Run with the vision. Write it down. Write it upon the table of your heart. Write it upon your forehead. Run with vision. Put it upon, you know, put it in front of your eyes and look at the vision. Run with purpose. I don't care who prays with you. I don't care who believes in your faith or not. I don't care who gives you, you know, help or not. I don't care who has a wrong definition of who you are or not. I don't care what is the lack in your life today. I want to encourage you. And Jesus finished his statement, and Jesus finished, you know, talking to these disciples of John the Baptist, and he told them, blessed is he who is not offended in me. And he continued by telling them, John the Baptist is not an ordinary person. John the Baptist is a prophet with a difference. John the Baptist is one of the greatest this generation has ever known. But he said, one of the most little in the kingdom, one of the most little in the kingdom, in the kingdom. What is the kingdom? The kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy. Where? In the Holy Ghost. The kingdom is that place of peace and rest, where you know that you know that you know that whatever God has told you will come to pass. No matter what your surrounding is showing you, what your circumstances tell you, who talks to you, who believes in you, or who doesn't believe in you, let me tell you, righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, the place of faith, the place of belief, the place of focus upon what God told you, where you know that you know that you know that if God said it, you believe it, it will come to pass. Jesus said, the little one, the most little one in the kingdom is greater than John the Baptist. In the kingdom. Was John the Baptist still in the kingdom when he asked that question? That is a question I'm going to leave with each and every one of us. I pray that God will give you the power of focus. I pray that God will give you the power of commitment. I pray that God will give you the power of faithfulness. I pray that God will give you the power of obedience to his ordinances and to his commandments. I pray that God will keep you faithful, running till the end, and that by the end of your run, you will have a legacy to
to live to your generation as a priest, as a pastor, as a woman of God, as an instrument in the hand of the Lord. Whatever be the area of your calling, whatever be the assignment that heaven has put upon you, I pray that at the end of your run, at the end of your course, you will receive an appreciation from the God of your salvation, and you will have something to give to this generation. May God bless His word. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you so much for lending us your time, your ear, and your heart. May God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.